Good evening to everyone on the west zone of the world, and good morning to everyone on the east zone. And we are trying to learn pranayama and how to combine pranayama. In pranayama, the varieties of the pranayama. So as we go into the course, we learn in detail. But right now, the pranayama for COVID, at least few techniques, so that will be very helpful to you. I have no intention of hiding any technique, understand? And there is no end to your learning, because so whatever I learned in 35 years in intense practice, so you can learn a lifelong. Because, so, as a serious aspirant in yoga from the childhood, and it's not that my grasping was very poor, my grasping was very, very high. So that there is a, you can learn anything very systematically. Only the thing is, you should not be in a hurry. The main thing a student should be committed. Why they said, Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha, not to leave the teacher? Because these days people think, no, I went to so-and-so teacher, already I did a course with him. But you should know, if that guru is, first you should verify, yes, if that guru is teaching only in one tradition, only one tradition he is practicing, only one tradition, only one school he went, that guru, then why you have to spend 5 years? You're spending there 5 years, it indicates you are a dummy. For ordinary physical yoga, yes, because Buddha spent to acquire sixth samadhi, it took only 6 months for him. And had Buddha decided to stay in one ashram, and his life span wouldn't have been sufficient enough, if you understand. But if the teacher and spent whole life in every ashram, in every tradition, went everywhere and in search of the truth, and then he found the truth, and then he comes back, and such a guru Shankaracharya is talking, such a guru the Sanatana Dharma talks, you should never leave. Because if you are picking up only some stuff for 3 months, 4 months, means you are like, you know, so what you picked up is, it is like a pigeon goes and one day, and when there are the grains under the tree, and it just picks up those grains, and it goes away. And next day, so some different place, different grains will be thrown. And if the pigeon thinks, you know, I already got my grains under that particular tree, and my learning is over, my feeding is over, and it is not wise. This is the main mistake we do in yoga. That is, so yes, there has to be a single guru, but the guru, as he told you, where are all the ashrams he went, and Yoga Alliance of America, and he asked me, so what are all the traditions I went, I have to give them, and all the traditions, and I have not mentioned all the traditions because that page is really not sufficient. So, it's a very, very important, and to whom to hold on to, and because so maximum, with the sharpest mind, like Buddha learnt in 6 months, if it's only a single tradition you are learning, it should not take more than 6 months. For example, so you are going to a younger, and 6 months is more than sufficient to, if you are smart enough, if you already have seen, it's not that you begin learning yoga with a younger, perhaps it might take 7-8 years for you. But a person like me, having spent everywhere in the northern traditions, having already learned, and with a thorough understanding of Vedanta, Laya Yoga, all the parts of the yoga, what is the difference between Hatha Yoga, and what is the difference between Swara Yoga, etc., if you compare. So maximum it takes only 6 months. Maximum it takes 6 months. Similarly, to understand the concept of Pratabhijoyas, and it takes maximum 6 months. In fact, it won't take 6 months under the Pattabhijas. Maximum it will take only, you know, so 2 months or 3 months. If you are smart enough, if you are smart enough, you can learn everything. Yeah, it's not that you are learning. In fact, the 3 months what I pick up, maybe you must have spent 30 years in the vinyasa, I am sure. And I can 100% tell you, you have not understood it. So the time duration you spend in ashram doesn't matter. Your preparation is very, very important. You know, how long you studied, prepared for the examination, it is all your interest. Main thing is the interest. And yes, your competency, your wisdom. And in fact, I felt I could have spent a little more time with Krishnamacharya. And it doesn't mean, because at that age, he did not accept any student. He stopped already teaching, or he stopped giving appointments. Especially after 95 years, he stopped giving appointments to anyone. I should tell you that. You know. And so, how much time? And there are some ashrams only. You have to learn one technique, he teaches you. Still he is a guru. And it only takes 1 week for you to learn, because he openly tells you, I only know this technique. And in many ashrams, they don't even know the theory. So you have to find the link to the theory somewhere in some ashram. So understand, spirituality is not a bonded labor to a tradition, or a bonded labor to a guru. The bonding is for your learning. Bonding is for your singularity. If there is a teacher who teaches you singularity, then you don't have to go anywhere. Had Iyengar, because Iyengar, my guru, had he given me the path to the singularity, I don't think I would have gone. Even to learn Hatha Yoga, I wouldn't have gone. Had I got a technique of singularity, or Atma Vidya, Brahma Vidya, and from Pattabhijas, I wouldn't have gone to and Krishnamacharya at all. I wouldn't go to any teacher. Had I learnt Brahma Vidya, Siddhanta Vichana from Shivananda Ashram, my first ashram, I wouldn't have gone to Satchananda Saraswati perhaps. Because my first mantra gave me the Samadhi. So morning 9 o'clock I sat, and in 1977, and by the time I opened my eyes, you know, so it was already 4 hours. And in fact, Satchananda Saraswati told me, hey Kumarena, there is nothing you can learn here, and because you already learned, go to the Kapilashram. He is the one who introduced me to Kapilashram in Bihar. Kapila is ashram, and that represents the most oldest school of yoga in India, and that is coming from Sankhya philosophy. Not many people have idea about it. It's the same school in Bihar. Perhaps the school when I went, they said that is the same school where, in fact, the Buddha pursued. And it's the same school established by Kapila himself, though Kapila is born in Kapilavastu. There are the people, there could be a people, but it's not a big ashram. Not necessary. If you are looking for 5-star ashrams only, then you get famous traditions when you look at, there only you get actually diverse. What you have to look for is not a small or a big. What you have to look for, how much popular he is, you should never be bothered. Popularity kills you, I tell you. The one who is popular, not at all an enlightened person. First thing you take. Popularity, the last teachers I went are the people with the popularity like Iyengar, or like in that too, way back in 1985-86. And because of one of my Westerner friend in Himalayas, he told me, hey, I think this, and you know, so have you gone to, you know, southern traditions, frankly speaking, in southern traditions, the people are very intellectual. When you go to Kerala or when you go to Tamil Nadu, but do you know one thing, they don't practice. They're very ritualistic, but they don't really practice meditation. There's no concept of meditation. Perhaps that is the reason why Krishnamacharya did not give any importance to the meditation. Because all that importance he has given is mindfulness of the breath in the movement. You know, I call it as a Buddhist meditation, a Buddhist tradition, meditation in the movement. I call Krishnamacharya's way of practicing yoga is meditation in the movement. For me it is, but that meditation in the movement is not sufficient. Simply meditation in the present not sufficient. There is a technology, there is a specified technique called Siddhanta Vichana. How you are, each stage you are passing through, what is your basis of actually understanding, analyzing, what you are, how you are developing Vairagya, the means of detachment is defined. That is the most important thing. Because these fundamental things today, having missed the selection of your guru, selection of your tradition, and I am just trying to tell you how it should be. There are many ashrams wherein you can spend only one day. I went to Mahabalipuram one day. So it is in Mamallapuram, it's called in Tamil Nadu. So it is many people visit there because it is a beach, a beautiful beach, and there is a architecture and archaeological importance, and it is a place for Shaivites and for Vaishnavites once upon a time, and ruled by a king, so it is a capital city, that's why it is so famous. I went there, it's called Mamallapuram. So one day I went, it's not for the pursuit of an entertainment. On my professional job I went, in fact. But then when I went there, and I found under a tree a fakir, a Muslim. So the one who practices yoga among the Islam or in the Muslims in India, they are called fakir. If you want to learn, fakir means the one who mastered Hatha Yoga. You should know there is a difference between fakir means who is a tantric, who practices on the chakras, who practices on Kriya Yoga. The one who practices Kriya Yoga is called a fakir. The one who doesn't have a fikr means the one who is free from any kind of tension. Anxiety, free from the tension, free from the anxiety, is called a fakir. So I saw him, the fakir. Fakirs, one thing about the fakirs are, they are like ordinary beings. It is up to the student to recognize the fakir. That's why they are called fakir. Fakir means also unknown, like Patanjali. A fakir means, Patanjali means unknown. What is his original name? No one knows. Similarly, the fakir means unknown. It is very difficult to identify a fakir. Very difficult to identify a yogi. Because this labeling of the tradition, as I told you, very corporate traditions, you must understand that that's not the way guru. A guru doesn't run the show. A guru doesn't establish, a monastery. The guru doesn't establish. It is down the level for some time. It is for his convenience of teaching something is established. He is very least bothered. Even at the time of the Buddha, and he said, if you want to construct a monastery, you construct. I am not interested at all. He is very, very vocal about it. A billionaire Mother Vaishaka, and she got enlightened. Her grandfather is a devotee of Buddha. And his name is called Mendaka. So at the time of the Buddha, every day I am giving you some stories, right? So at the time, when Buddha just got enlightened at that time, he is very young, at the age of 35 years, considered to be very young. And when he got enlightened, all the billionaires, because king, he is a prince, and he is a well-known prince in all the dynasties, and a very good child. And it is known to everyone, he left the kingdom means he definitely is like a Rama. Everyone knows. And he never lies anything. And when he claimed that, when King Bimbisara, the Magadha dynasty declared, he is an enlightened person, means that's absolutely, everyone would believe, no one would doubt. And today, everyone doubts because you do not know the criteria. But in those days, they know the criteria. Because Buddha, fact, Buddha had every chance even to become a supreme king of Magadha itself. So everyone knows. And he just sacrificed everything. And Buddha. So Buddha, many billionaires used to invite. Mandaka. Mandaka is the most richest person. The most richest man. Mandaka, the richest, he belongs to Magadha dynasty. He is in Rajagaha. And he owns his own town. And so the story goes, why he is called as a Mandaka? Because, and so he is born in a business class family. And then he is super rich by birth. Not only that, one day it so happened when he went behind. Yeah, so in those days, billionaires mean they have big mansions. And big mansions. And on the backyard you have a garden. And so one day he is plowing the garden. And when he is plowing the garden behind his home, at home, and it is that is his hobby. And when he is plowing, and he found his plow stuck to a solid material. And when so the solid material that stuck to the plow blade and sounds like a metal, because he knows he is not uneducated, he comes from very well educated family, and then he wanted to just check. And then when he dug and he found a big antelope size, means antelope is like a horse, antelope is like, you know, so a bull, and size is gold. And not only he found one, then he found entire backyard as he went on and digging, and he found entire backyard is full of these and full size gold antelopes. And then it's the mandatory, any billionaire finds it to inform the king. And he informed the king Bimbisara about and his findings. And the young Bimbisara, being a very good person, he told, hey, your family is a billionaire family. Your ancestors must have paid the tax. You don't have to pay any tax. That is your own property. And the Mandaka owned the entire property, and he has become number one billionaire at the time in India. Who is the number one billionaire? And at the time when Buddha and just got enlightened, billionaire, that is the richest billionaire, is the Mandaka. Means he has a gold. What he, as a king, what he doesn't have in his kingdom, an entire gold equality in his kingdom is equivalent to the Mandaka's gold treasure. He discovered the treasure of the gold. That's why his name is named as Mandaka, means antelope. So that's why he is named after, the original name is gone, and he is named after Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. No one will say, everyone says Gandhi. It's something like that. So we go by nicknames. So, and his nickname is, oh, that gold, that antelope gold. So that antelope, only they remembered him. So his name became an antelope. And one thing I tell you is, as I told you, he's very educated, very disciplined. Because he's very close to the king, and he knows the entire story, as a Prince Siddhartha, and you know how he left and how he pursued, and for sure he knows, he discovered the way out of suffering, a self-realization techniques mean, for sure he knows. That's why the first person to invite and the Buddha in a grand, because he's a billionaire, and he has the highest quality of sacrifice, charity, is an excellent billionaire, not a billionaire of conjuice or miserliness. No. And that's the reason, and he is the one who lavish. No. So all the monks and invited. And when he invited, he just had a son. His son name is called Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya is one of the air element. So among, you know, pranayama we are practicing. So Devadatta, Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya means Arjuna, the warrior. Dhananjaya, why Dhananjaya? It is not because of the warrior. Dhananjaya is not the original name of the Arjuna. He is called Dhananjaya because he attained a samadhi. And the samadhi, once you attain a level of perfection, the meditation, say fourth samadhi, third samadhi, fifth samadhi, and your every relic after your death and your every portion of your every atom in you, even ash of you or a nail, any even one atom of you, one DNA of you carries and your entire quality in that. Today you can see, you know, in Himalayas and in Arctic region, when they go for exploration and archaeologists, etc., in deep Russia and remote Russian areas, and when they dig, they find some DNA, because in that coldest temperatures, and some DNA, just one DNA they find, and I can isolate. Means what? They can create the same species. You see? The same species. And that belongs to maybe which Jurassic period. But once you get a DNA, means you can create another dinosaur. Understand? You can create it today using the technology. You can create the same species called mammoths. They are called yetis in Himalayas. Yetis means very big beings. Yesterday I was telling about Himayati. You know, yeti means very big beings. And these beings, from Himalayas, the same, north to the Himalayas, in Russia, in remote control, remote, yak, mammoths means yak. And the yak represents, and the most oldest animal in Himalayas that survived is called yak. And the size of the yak, like I was telling you, like a bull, very huge. As you go into the yaks of Himalayas, and the yak is called yetis, you use yaks. And they know how to grow them. That's why it's called yak. Yak, if yak is there, means yeti is there. So this yak culture, the yak is called mammoths. And now, in deep Russia, and people could find big, huge yaks. And their DNA they could find. Means you can create that kind of gigantic mammoths of the yak. Yesterday I was telling you, what we know, and as of now, about our own history, about our own planet, about the size of big humans, it is still, we have not discovered, it doesn't mean it's not there, we just have to discover it. So this, why am I telling you, Dhananjaya, the air element, why any monk when he dies, when your parents die, and he is buried, some memory is collected. Every temple, say Sai Baba temple or Buddha, all that Buddha, when he passed away, Buddha knew there will be a vast for his relics. Relics means for his remaining. Once he leaves the body, and the fighting for the body begins. The dead body, and once it is burnt, and whatever the bones they get, whatever the ashes you get, there will be very big fight. He could foresee, that's why. Why? Because in India, even today, when parents die, or when your grandparents die, any saint die, even today in Buddhist countries, what they preserve is, and after you burn your pipe, they collect your bones, and they collect your ashes. And those ashes, and they merge it in the Himalayas or somewhere. But actually, even in pyramid is nothing but, you see, the kings and the queens, dead bodies. Why they want to preserve? Because someday technology comes, you can again reproduce them. The same figure, the same thing. It's not the same technology exists in India for a long time. And you don't need even DNA. Means as per the Indian technology, you just need that value to reproduce your character is called Dhananjaya. What it carries means your RFID. So you are called your radio frequency and identity. So RFID, and whatever we are born, when the soul is born, you have an identity. And that identity of consciousness is called a Dhananjaya. So Dhananjaya means, in all forms of your lifetimes, And your mass, it represents the irrespective birth, in which form the mass is there, in which form it left, the consciousness left. That is the last air element. And that air element is all the time. Even Kumar goes, but Kumar body or Kumar air, even after Kumar soul goes into the Supreme Soul, but and say Buddha's and a hair follicle or a nail will carry another Kumar, living Kumar. It is like a living Buddha. Like living, any belonging to the Jesus, say, is as good as the Jesus living. Because only technology right now is not matured enough. If the technology is there, you can recreate the same person. And means the technology of the saints is far superior to the DNA. DNA is still you are looking for some transcription file. To translate it. So transcription means, so Dhananjaya is like a dark energy, identification of dark energy. Each one of us, we have a different level of dark energy, dark matter, gravity. And DNA is a gross reality compared to any of those things. So saints form, they named it as a Dhananjaya. Simply Dhananjaya means, why Arjuna got Dhananjaya? Because he got and he meditated on the Shiva and he got the blessing of the Shiva. Shiva gave him a powerful weapon. So he conquered a technique, a technology. That's how he has become a famous the archer. And in the archer, what is the highest level of the, what can one can achieve the, in the archery? And Arjuna, the great warrior, got it. That's why he is a great archer. That is his legacy. Means his focus, his concentration, his samadhi is very high. He's a tantric. Before, had his brother-in-law did not help him, and simply he's an egoistic fellow. Because he's a tantric, he attained it, and the Dhananjaya. That's why, and Buddha used, Krishna uses in Bhagavad Gita, all the names meant for Arjuna. And he reminds him about the character of Dhananjaya. Hey, you have this samadhi. When Dhananjaya, Arjuna, Bharata, Kaunteya, like this. You know, so what not? So we, appropriately, wherever, whichever the word required, Krishna and uses that word for Arjuna. That shows his competency, his skill, his weakness, everything it indicates. So when he referred to Dhananjaya, means wherever the shloka, he refers to Dhananjaya, you should understand. He is making mockery of him. Hey, you are only at that samadhi level, you are far away. So in Buddhist traditions, in India tradition, the culture, it has become a culture. Even in the West, it is a culture. A dead body, you want to bury it. And in India, we burn it. Whether you burn it, bury it the same, isn't it? Everything has to be degraded. It is a slow degradation, it is a fast degradation. And in Indian tradition is, so because once you bury, any virus is there, it will continue. You know, that's why what in India they do is incineration, the most modern, the best way to, actually any person suffering from a virus, if he is a dead, what is the best way? Is to burn. That is only the best way. And frankly speaking, and anyone like you know, one affected with Ebola virus and one affected with a COVID virus, without even a blink of the eye, you just have to burn. Because you are thinking and he is, you know, so his body doesn't carry his memory. No. Whether you burn his ashes, his bone, everything and carries. And Buddha and told 3 months before he left his body, he told, hey, I'm going to leave this body and there will be a fight. Hey, Ananda, there will be a fight. And in order to avoid the fight, so I'm only telling you first, so call that Brahmin, Drona the king, who is a Brahmin. So my friend, who belongs to my grandmother's place. Because he is liked by everyone. Every king knows about him. He told, hey, call Drona, the king. and from Kolya, so because Buddha belongs to a kingdom called Kolya. And that place is, you know Kolya? What is a Kolya? Kolya is a tree name. It's called Ashwatthama. Tree called, it's also called Ashwatthama, tree of Ashwatthama. And the name, it is a typical Himalayan forest tree. Often it's called Sanjeevani. So the Kolya and so Buddha legacy, Buddha mother, Buddha grandmother, grandfather. And grandfather name is called great grandfather, name is called Rama, the king. The Rama king comes from, he is a Rama, the king actually is the king of the Varanasi, Kashi. And he is a Brahmin, but he is a king. And then Kashi, the king of the Kashi and Varanasi, why he went to Kolya? So Kolya is originally not a kingdom. Kolya is only a forest, Himalayan forest. But that particular area of the forest has significance. What significance? Because that forest is full of these trees only. Kolya trees only. And then what for that forest is famous? Because Buddha's great-grandmother, and she got a disease like COVID virus. COVID virus is a pandemic. So in those days also virus. So in those days, a cancer or like a TB or tuberculosis or a cancer, it's called cancer. Cancer is, you know, skin cancer. So many cancers, say the disease. Any one means for sure they will die. Once you are diagnosed of a cancer, they know you are going to die. And in those days, the only cure in the elite class is known. And like Rama knows, because Vibhishana knows. And so that, you know, so the Lord Hanuman flew to Himalayas, and poor person, he doesn't know which herb, and he picked up entire mountain carrying these trees, and he brought to Sri Lanka. That story you know very well. So Himalayas, the forest, there is Kolya tree. Not everyone knows. And in that forest, any animal living in this forest, that animal and did not suffer any type of any disease. They observed in that forest, no animal has any disease. And it has become since the time of the Pandavas, time immemorial, and this forest is preserved. And that's why, and any king or anyone and who are diagnosed with the disease, so if they leave the kingdom and they go into and that forest, and it is very well known. And because this forest, and once you go into this forest, it is like a monk in Himalayas, even today Tibetan Lama, and after 4 years of practice within the doors, within the four walls, and if he successfully passes out, and he will be sent into the forest next 14 years. And once he goes into the forest, if he comes back, he will be a Lama. And if he doesn't come back, means he developed a strong desire, detachment, and he is not interested to come back. And he left the body, or he would be meditating in some cave, it means. Understand? He entered into a box, it means. The tradition was still, it is there. So once you go into this forest, and even you get cured, but the desire of going back, again ruling, or desire of going back and again doing an umpire, it will go away, vanish. Because that's a forest of Vairagya. And many monks, many saints meditated. That's why the trees have a special character. So Buddha's, this Lord Rama had the same disease, and Buddha's great-great-grandmother had the same disease. And so he left the the kingdom, and he went into that forest as an ordinary people person. And he has to, when he left with ordinary robes like in sannyasi, he went into that forest, and Buddha's and great grandmother also went into that forest because she also had the disease. And one day it so happened, and they got cured, both of them got cured completely. And one day it so happened, she had a vairagya and he had a vairagya. And they did not want to go back, and they're meditating. And one day it so happened, and in a small river at the time, so they want to fish, they go to the river for bathing and for fishing. And so happened, they went to the river, and there, so they happened to see each other. And there is a beautiful lake, it is not a river, it is a lake, and on the lake bed, so, and they met, and they fell in love, as I said. And you know, so just like Maitreya and Gargi in the king of the Janaka, and when Yajnavalkya got enlightened, they got married. You should not think the marriage is only for sex. Totally wrong. And if you think, you know, so Gargi, it is not at all, that is not the goal. The goal is different. In fact, the very purpose of marriage is to continue the progeny of actual enlightenment. That is the most powerful way of channelizing. The marriage is only for pursuing the singularity, not for giving the birth to the children at all. And giving an opportunity to the children also to get enlightened, because both parents are enlightened. That is the purpose of the marriage. That's why it's called Kalyana. Kalyana means highest. Kalyana means flying off. Kal means time. The journey into timelessness is called Kalyana. That is the most welfare, that is the highest welfare, the highest beneficial thing is. And today, as you can see in the Tibetan Tantra, is a phallus and all. So a male and a minus pole, and when they combine and the attraction is very high, the power becomes a huge, because that energy is channelized. They can go beyond physical, they can go beyond subtler body, beyond mind, and beyond soul. Very easy to go. Very easy to go. That's why they used a marriage means an engineered association of an opposite poles. An engineered sexual relationship. It is an engineered sexual relationship. A programmed sexual relationship. This is what the spirituality talks about. You will see a programmed sexual relationships means for sure you are going to give a children, you are going to birth to the children, and though children, you are giving a birth to the children not for a desire to use them as a dolls, Barbie dolls. But the whole purpose is giving liberation to those souls. Because Kalyana means once you get enlightened, after enlightenment only you give a birth. And once you get enlightened, and your children, like Rama and Sita, fully enlightened. But do you mean they did not give the birth? They have given the birth to the Lava and Kusha. And you know, so where Lava and Kusha are brought up? In the ashram. In the ashram, in the monastic discipline. And it is very well known. People don't properly understand. And so there is a saying in Buddhism, in not Mahayana tradition, but when you go in the Hinayana tradition and all your people say, hey, an enlightened person, you know, how he will get married? If you are not, you have a vairagya, you don't want to get married, no one will force. You are called sannyasi, but not necessary. Being a Buddha also gave a chance. Being a householder also you can get enlightened. But there is a misrumor goes on. And you are a family holder, but you know, you got enlightened. First of all, now the present generation, they don't believe. The present intellectual tank, they don't believe. I'm saying that's a wrong notion. And they don't believe. And if you are a family holder, means you will not get enlightened at all. Totally wrong. Vairagya, the detachment is at the volition level, Buddha himself talks. They are nothing to do. And Buddha has proven in many occasions, even lay people got fully enlightened. And there is also an occasion they have not become monks, even after fully enlightened. So it is before Buddha in entire Indian tradition. When you say 6-7 great saints, all of them got married. And all of them had the children. And they carried forward. And even today we carry our Gotra because of them. And you know, yesterday I was talking about the demon king Ravana Asura and his brother and Kumbhakarna. And he is a Brahmin. Even today, and the people carry a Gotra called Kumbhakarna Gotra. Kumbhakarna Gotra, there is a girl, Gotra called Kumbhakarna Gotra. Means, why Kumbhakarna? Because he is a tantric and he has a practice. And like his brother, all of them are the tantrics. They have the magical powers. And he is a Brahmin. And even today, his legacy continues, his progeny continues. That's why I said. So when you look at your gene, India is only the thing which maintains. Of course, in the West also is there, called family tree. What is a family tree? So your family tree is one, Gotra. What is the lineage? What is the lineage? Gotabhanana. The one who changed the lineage. Buddha calls it the Gotrabhanana. Gotrabhanana means the one who has enlightened. The one who changed germ immortality to immortality. Eternality, the journey. That's called Gotrabhanana. And the same even today we carry. And you know, so when I have to give, when you go to any temple, when you perform any puja, even in India, today, and so they will refer your Gotra. First they will ask your family tree, from which saint you are coming from. So there is no caste in India, there is no religion in India. There is no religion, there is no caste. There is only one thing called family tree. And just by checking your Gotra, they will, you belong to Vasishta. Vasishta Gotra. Oh, you belong to Bharadwaja Gotra. Oh, you belong to Markandeya Gotra. Oh, you belong to Marichi Gotra. So this is how. It is not only one, there is no caste in India. Everyone carries only. Family tree. Family tree means a saint. Whether you belong to a low caste, very high caste, low profession, high profession, doesn't matter at all in India. And your journey begins from that lineage of enlightened ones. That's why they are called Gotra. Kaundinya Gotra. Maudgalya Gotra. So like this Gotras are carried forward, and I'm just trying to tell you, so how the legacy is DNA. So in that forest, grandparents, Buddhas, so Rama, and so they met. They are both of them developed serious detachment. Now these things should fly off. Staying at home. As a family holder, you are not enlightened. All these intellectual, by reading books, and the one who doesn't meditate, all these things start popping up. And there will be a big debate, and there will be a big discussions. You know, how come in a fully enlightened person, and you know, so like now in the Buddhist circles, how come, you know, so he can, how come he will have. Buddha is talking about the one who left, about the monk, different. As a householder, is different. Entire Indian tradition is talking about being a householder, how to enlighten. Because that is the shortest path. The longest path is going as a sannyasi, going as a monk is the longest path. And staying like a householder is the shortest cut to the enlightenment. This is what Buddha discovered. And so they had a serious detachment. So, and Buddha's grandmother and the king Rama, Varanasi. So they met in the forest, they got married. Who is Buddha's lineage? To whom Buddha is born? So Buddha born there. And Buddha is born there. That's why he had all those qualities. So his DNA, his RNA, his lineage itself represents, and from where they come from. and not many people know about it. And the Koliya, and when Buddha was about to leave his body, he wanted, and so all his body relics have to be distributed to all the seven kingdoms. The major kingdoms are the seven, and he wanted to distribute to all those seven kingdoms. And he told his cousin Ananda, and he told, the one who is acceptable, the one who is a Brahmin, only should carry that, because all other people will obey. So kings won't fight, so wars won't happen between the kingdoms. That's the Buddha's intention. So then he told, Kal Drona is the king, he's a Brahmin of the Koliya. He told, Kal Drona. And Drona came. And when Buddha, after his body is incinerated, and then so all his bones and everything is collected very well, and they are made into seven parts. And Buddha also told him, and he told him not to tell anyone, Drona. And Drona, and because Buddha's head, and it is ordinary, so gods wanted, Brahmins, or angels wanted, and that's why, and angels wanted his head and remaining body, and he wanted. So Buddha has to, because Buddha taught Abhidhamma to the angels. Angels also wants to meditate, wants to carry the legacy. Then his skull is given for all the all the higher realms, all this. And he told Drona, so you carry my skull. And you carry my skull, it will be protected by the gods. Because it is a property of them. It is not a property of the humans. It is not a property of any kingdom. And you own it and you take it. And in my kingdom where I am, where my grandmother is born, and there you go, and there you bury. Is what he told. And Drona took his skull, and all other are distributed. So why? And even today, Shwedagan Pagoda in Myanmar, what for it is famous? Because it is believed the king Buddha's hair follicle is there. You think, hey, ordinary person thinks, hey, world has gone mad? So if you believe in the DNA, this is much more powerful concept than DNA. Understand? So Dhananjaya, it is as good as Buddha is living there in the Shwedagan Pagoda, you should know. It is he's a nail, tip of a nail, is it true, Kumar? Now, the modern, because we are talking about prana, so Dhananjaya is a prana, I am just giving it. So now, you will be sent to moon, and we are sending the people to, Mars, before sending, and what people do, so whether you can cope with that kind of the stress, anti-gravity environment, you will be kept in a simulator. You will be kept in the simulator for a period of 6 months, to the duration equivalent to in the space, what you are planning, the similar environment is created. So in America, and there is called Hawaii. This Hawaii is a very famous place for experimentation. NASA has an experimental station in Hawaii, and every astronaut before he is going to spend, suppose now Mars mission, and the people will be trained creating a simulator, a Mars kind of the environment around you completely, the anti-gravity and the similar atmosphere they create, and they have to live in their suits exactly like in the space station. They have to live there for about a period of 6 months in Mars simulator. They have to live in 6 months. So then what they study? So all these astronauts, they have to cut their hair. They have to shave their hair once in a week. And so their blood once in a week. And their especially hair is given. So they have to cut their hair. And so sample will come out. And every week, the hair falling hair is monitored. Why only hair? Why only hair? Because hair remembers your emotional, your physical, physiological, psychological, mental, all memories and all memories and can be diagnosed from the hair. That's why, and the one who has erased all the memories is called a shaven head. A Shankaracharya doesn't carry any hair on that. A Buddha doesn't carry any hair on his head. Shaven heads. And the Vedic culture is talks about only, and if you, whether you are a Vedic culture or a Tantric culture is only known by your hair. In the Vedic culture, there is no growing of the hair because detachment, practice of detachment, if you want to practice, are you in the practice of detachment, attachment is known. The one who is growing hair means he is going for the power. They are not given value. So you are going for the power like Ravana, Asura, etc. The one who doesn't grow hair means you are Sanatana Dharma. You are practicing, you are there to erase the memory. That's all. To deactivate the memory, Chitta Vritti Nirodaha, Kshura, Kshura Karma. Kshura means cutting off the memory. Hair remembers. So the most important is called Kesha Karma. So every Wednesday in India, one has to cut their hair. The most auspicious day is only Wednesday. If not Wednesday, then Saturday. Kesha Karma, there are certain, every day, you know, so in the tradition of yoga, and there are certain Nitya Naimittika Karmas. Every day we are supposed, every week, every day there are certain karmas which we have to do. And every week there are certain karmas we have to do. And there are, and Nakha. So Nakha means nail cutting. Has to happen every week. Varanta karma is called weekend karma or week karma. This nail cutting. And similarly hair cutting called masika karma. So means every month you have to cut your hair if you are a family holder. Or if you are sannyasi, means every day you have to shave your hair. Every day you have to shave. That's why a monk is supposed to have blade in his. No, a monk is allowed to carry a blade all the time with him because he should not allow any memory to grow. Hair represents memory. Your psychological, your past history. So the one who is going there to change their past, remove their past, that is why the hair really has influence on you. That's why in olden days you can see all heroes. Hero means who doesn't have a hair. Villain means who has a hair. Now, down 50 years, now hero means who is growing the beard. And the villain means who doesn't have a beard. You can understand what a cultural change, what a dummies we have become, and you know what a useless culture. Who we are worshipping now? Villains actually. And the one who is growing a beard, and he is called a villain 50 years back. You take English movie, Hollywood movie, Bollywood movie, Tollywood movie, you take. And now all hero means he should have a beard. Lazy guys, useless guys, and they don't have time to shave, and now we worship them as heroes. It indicates why he is called a hero, because everyone knows Rama and all those great people, they never grow beard, they never grow hair. And suddenly meanings change, books change, and people start worshipping. And now, so so-called gurus grow their hair. The tantrics. The one who is, and Shankaracharya, Dhanyanini, shaven head. And even at the time of the Buddha, they are called shaven heads. Because what were prevailing techniques? Tantric. Techniques. When Buddha was there, witchcraft practices are existing, tantric techniques existing, samadhi techniques existing. What was not existing? Enlightenment is not existing. When Buddha discovered, all his predecessors have no hair because they removed the memory. Then he restored that legacy of shaving the head. People should know in India, he's a great Brahmin. He restored the legacy of the Brahmin, the Vedic culture. Detachment. And Shankaracharya, anyone you look at, and this even basic thing, when you go to the Kriya Yoga, and you know in Himalayan tradition you have to grow hair. It builds prana. It doesn't build pride. Forget about the prana. It builds ego. It builds memory and concentration, power. The power mongers, attention seekers, the demon kings, they only grow hair, the spirituality. Basic understanding is missing today. And the very choosing the criteria of the guru itself, if you know the standards of the Veda or a pramana of the actual spirituality, just looking at a teacher you will know. Do you think Krishnamacharya, the great Brahmin at 100 years, and who studied, who is graduated from, you know, Banaras Hindu University, Queen's College, in the Sanskrit, and who went on to practice Vedanta, studied, and went into Tibet, do you think he has grown hair? No. Because he knows what is the Kesha Karma. You have to cut your hair once in a month. If you are a sannyasi, you have to cut every day. A blade is all the day. What is allowed is a blade in your back. It is not to kill anyone. It is to shave your head. Because to ensure you have forgot yesterday. You are living in this moment. That's why you have to shave. I got habituated for shaving in the ashram. That's why you will never find in my entire life unshaven, and you know, so jar unshaven head you will never find. My beard always clean, clean shave. It's not today. That indicates in the ashram it is considered as a sin if you are growing your hair. Now I will see even in Vedic ashrams they grow the hair. Lazy Brahmins are growing the hair. What can I tell you? And one is competing with the other, and all the India has become like. You know who does this? The one who is highly egoistic. Tantrics and the kings, high supreme ego. Now you grow mustaches and you grow this, you know, beards and you know, and all the time. What is this? What you are trying to show? A monkey even doesn't show its tail at least. This is how, you know, why I tell you. If you are listening to this discourse, you should know the, what is original, traditional, what we have lost in the spirituality, where is the spirituality? There is no spirituality at all. A person who doesn't know about the hair, and you know, so he is talking about that spirituality is a guru, he doesn't even know the difference between a samadhi path and enlightenment path. And first thing I tell my students, when they come for yoga training, are you growing your beard? Of course, I don't force. But a sensible person, any of my student, had he been growing a beard, you know, so I tell, they start shaving. In fact, and I, you know, so because my routine is regularly I shave, I wanted to know the pramana of the shaving also. Which hair, which shaving brush you should use, and what blade you should use. How the science of shaving, very, very important, because my time is important, and whether clean shave is there or not, very important. Many people shave, but it's not a clean shave, because they do not know. That also you have to be taught in the ashrams. In the ashram, everything is taught, how to cut a nail, not how to polish a nail, how to cut your nail, not how to grow the nail, how to cut your nail. And how to shave your hair, how to shave your beard, how to check whether any traces are there or not. Not downward, it is only upward when you do like this. Nothing should touch. By only evening it should touch. But morning nothing should touch. I see so many of my students, whether you are coming from a cultured family or are known only by these simple basic things. I see so many people don't even have basic culture, forget. Forgotten. Lazy. Why hair is gross? Tamasic. The one who is tamasic. Tamasoma jyotirghamaya. The one who has inertia. The one who loves darkness. The one who is lazy is called tamasic. Inertia. It doesn't represent Chetana at all. And it's exploring the world of inertia, exploring the world of energy, exploring the world of killing other demon kings. Yes, Lord Vishnu took avatar of the lion. Yes, lion will have whatever it has here, it has everywhere. That's a different issue. So, don't misinterpret whatever I'm explaining. Understand, I am not prejudiced. Many of my gurus also had Hatha Yoga, in Kriya Yoga tradition, wherever I went. I'm telling you, the Kriya Yoga tradition, they grow the beards, but not gurus, they grow the beards, but they are Tantra practitioners, you should know, they're not the Vedic practitioners. You know, so the world faced the problems with them because of their powers. You should know, everything in yoga is not clean. There's a bad periods in yoga, and yoga is used like Buddha, no one practiced yoga for detachment. Everyone started practicing yoga has become a power mongering. And if you really study the history of yoga, if you say, now you go to the Bengal, the east side in India, and you call, and you know, if the child is not eating the meal, and mother says, Yogini will come. No, Yogini means fully enlightened actually. But why they call, Yogini means vampire. Why they call, even today, a child is not eating the meal, a child is kept in the arm, and if she is not eating, in South India we call, you know, devil will come if you don't eat, and child gets scared and she eats. That is the worst way of programming the child's brain, I tell you. That's a different issue. That's what I'm telling mothers, which word they should never use, you know, fear, and in making the child, child is eating especially, because eating is a parasympathetic activity, not a sympathetic activity. When child eats, child should be calm, free from the fear, free from the anger, free from any kind of the negativity, calmness. Then only child should eat, then that food assimilates, digests. That's the first important thing, that food heals. Otherwise food kills. If you are in anger, if you are in lust, and at that time when you eat, in sympathetic mode when you eat, it already your serotonin is blocked, your leptin is blocked, and you eat like a demon. And your gastric juice doesn't have the finest of biochemicals like BPC-157 molecule, and that's why, and it leads to, and nutrition doesn't get absorbed at all. The science is behind that. It is not simply betaine hydrochloride is the juice produced here. So I'm talking Yogini in West Bengal, and if the child, you know, so it is not it. Yogini will come. Yogini means for me, it is a great word actually. But you should know, Yogini means vampire, female vampire. Why that name came? Because whoever pursued path of yoga, like doing these asanas and doing the mantras and practicing the chakras, what they have done? They went after the women, they went after the kings, they went for power mongering, power, showing the power. That's why people are afraid of the Nath Gurus, people are afraid of the Kapalikas, Bhairavas, kings are afraid of yoginis. You should know. So, everyone knows. Yoga as tantric and yoga as Vedic. So pursuit should be Vedic. Krishnama, when you go to because Krishnamacharya went to Himalayas, I went to Himalayas, we know the finest of the difference. But the one who has not seen any of these legacies, cultures, and totally got confused, is practicing Vamachara practices, Tantra practices. Tibetans pursuing Tantra practice not for the powers. It is for perfection. It is for the Vairagya. And we pursuing the powers and thinking this is the way to the enlightenment, totally wrong. It is experience mongering techniques, all Kundalini techniques. Understand? Yeah, of course. It is not that a Yajnavalkya doesn't know. But then he takes you from there to, depending on your temperament, he takes you from there to detachment, path of attack. Conditioning is to decondition. Pravritti dharma is for Nivritti Dharma. Entire tantra is called Pravritti, means conditioning, conditioning, conditioning. And at appropriate time, it has to be again deconditioned. So, like Buddha could decondition himself, because for him to attain 8th samadhi, he conditioned. The shift, if there is no shift, you become a Ravanasura, a demon king. It happens. So they got, so Buddha told Drona, and Drona and kept his carried even today. And when King Ashoka, just 200 years after Buddha passed away, you know, and King Ashoka came. King Ashoka means 3rd century BC. So just 200 years means not much, you know, because being a Buddha prince still, the legacy is continuing. King Ashoka, and what King Ashoka did, 3rd BC, and King Ashoka, so he is a cruel king and became, because Buddhism was, all the monks, enlightened monks were still there. It is just 200 years that Buddha passed away and he got a great guru, so, and Ashoka, and then he got enlightened. When he got enlightened, first thing, and when he got enlightened, the King Ashoka, he realized this, oh my God, what a legacy of the Buddhas I need to preserve. And all his relics, wherever, in whichever the kingdom buried, it is the one who has restored and who constructed properly a monument over his stupa, constructed a memory, and so that even today those memories are surviving. That credit goes to the one who recognized the importance of the relic, and the King Ashoka. But in one place he could not do, because he wanted to go to Kolia, it's called Ramagrama. Grama means village, where Buddha's grandmother and grandfather met, and where they got married, and his great-great-grandmother. So that place today is called in Nepal Ramagrama. And Ramagrama, and so Ramagrama, why it's famous? Not many Buddhist circuit know. Ramagrama is famous because where Buddha's skull is buried. And King Ashoka was trying, he was successful in edicting all Buddha's stupas. Even he could see previous Buddha's stupas also erected. That is his devotion. And including where Buddha is born. But when he went to this place called Ramagrama, when he is trying to actually and construct, and there is, because it is owned by the gods, and gods never allowed him. So there are called dragons or yakshas, and protected by the Vishnu, protected by the Kubera, and it is protected by the Kubera, the king of the gods of the fifth plane of sixth plane of consciousness, and no one, and even Nepalese government, whenever they tried, and something or the all other great calamities happened. That's why the only unedicted means untouched. And relic stupa, natural stupa, that he has been surviving since the Buddha's death. Since the Buddha left his body, is only called Ramagrama, even today. Is untouched. That's why if one goes to touch, they will die. So if a bad intention of taking anything over there, if you are going there to pay gratitude, no problem at all. But if you are trying to go there, dig out something and to construct something, and even Nepal government so far has not constructed anything, because, and they essentially, whenever they tried, so many people died. And it is recorded since the time of the Ashoka. That's why, no, even British tried, and so happened they died. So that's why, so this is only the Buddha's skull, the most powerful place. If you are enlightened, you know, so then you will know. What is the power of that place? So every relic, even in my state, there are some relics of the Buddha which are very powerful. When you say Nagarjuna, so Acharya Nagarjuna, the Vice Chancellor of the Nalanda University, he comes from my state and he carried forward his legacy. Monastic, another university here in my state. And you know, now there is a dam and all are preserved, including Buddha's nail. It is preserved in my state. That's why, for me to be born in this land, I am born where I am delivered is a Buddhist site. It's called Phanigiri. Where I am delivered, So if I have to tell you, it all is not our choice. So it, nature will take care. So that's all. The what nature takes care, your Dhananjaya, where your matter carries. How do you know where a person is enlightened? So in Buddhist countries, even today they carry forward the legacy. Do you know how they identify a person is enlightened or not? Any person dies in their village, in Myanmar, in Thailand, in Sri Lanka, or anywhere, especially in Myanmar, in Thailand, still this tradition goes. And what they do, any person, any monk, and villagers collect these relics, or monks collect. If he is a monk dead, and monk relics are collected. A villager passed away, and so they collect the relics. And they store in a glass jar, they store. And you will see after 1 year, 2 years, and they become translucent. It will become. The translucent, they change the structure. They become like a pearls. They become like a diamonds. They become like a value-added stones. They undergo transformation. And that is how they recognize whether that person, Dhananjaya Vayu, is immortal or not. A Dhananjaya, whose Dhananjaya Vayu is immortal, I mean there is no more birth. And they will identify by entropy-less. So when this relic, and simply it has become churna, it has become powder, means he is not fully enlightened. Understand? But if that has remained its integrity, still it is surviving, and it has become smooth and polished, and like a crystal, means that person is enlightened. And like this, you will find Ajahn Mun's relics collected in the Thai traditions. That is the authenticity of the traditions. When you go to learn, you should see so many parameters are there to know and whether those people are enlightened. That's why even today you go to Sringeri, you will find some memory of the Shankaracharyas, very kept auspiciously. When you go to Shirdi Sai Baba and you find, so these fakirs, sandals and everything, they are the most cherished valuables, because they indicate their presence, their energy. Even one atom is there enough. One atom is there enough for you to synchronize, for you to get affected. Good is good. One radioisotope, highly active, can influence entire environment around you. Can cure all the diseases. So you should know. So similarly, a bad radioisotope, and when nuclear explosion is there, released, polonium is released, and it will affect everyone with the thyroid. It will kill everyone with the cancer. I'm just trying to tell you the power of atom, power of isotope, which you won't even see. So when you see, correct, Kumar. So this is also correct. So radioisotope of a enlightened person, and what energy it carries forever the legacy. So that's why when you go to Pondicherry, so the mother Aravindo and the mother, like this, everywhere when you go to Dakshinapan and Vivekananda Samadhi and Mahatma Gandhi Samadhi and the dome, the culture is very well. But which you have to visit, you must visit. And if any enlightened person's relics are, if you are sure, you should never miss that opportunity. Because for sure you will get enlightened one day. So that's how the legacy of the Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya is what? Mother Vishakha's father name is Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya father is Mendaka, the one who discovered that golden antler. So he invited Buddha, and this girl is 7 years old. When the first time Buddha is invited, she's just 7 years old girl, when her grandfather invited. And so the way Buddha invited, and the way that family prepared, the way this girl prepared to invite the Buddha, so with the silk dress wearing, and all jewelry wearing, a traditional way of welcoming, and a grand welcoming ceremony conducted for Buddha, and the way the grandfather spoke about the Buddha, and his mother Vishakha, and longing to see that great Buddha, she's so inspired to see. The moment she saw the Buddha, and the moment she saw the Buddha, her devotion goes, and she went into a rapture. And the moment the Buddha And even before he entered into the village, she went along with her friends outside the village to welcome the Buddha. And when Buddha saw her and Buddha and you know spoke to her, at that point of time itself she got enlightened. So the first girl, the first female who got enlightened and under the Buddha, he is not a nun. She is an ordinary girl. She is a 7-year-old girl and her name is called Vishakha. Vishakha is a granddaughter of the Mendaka and her father is a Dhananjaya. So Dhananjaya story I told. What is Dhananjaya? And who is Dhananjaya? Because one word when I tell, and it's my duty to tell you, what does it mean? So because we are practicing pranayama, among the pranayama, there are the vayus. They have the names. And those tantrics, and those Vedic, those saints have not named. Apanaya swaha, samanaya swaha, udanaya swaha, vyanaya swaha, krukaraya swaha, nahaya swaha, devadattaya swaha, dhananjayaya swaha. They have not named because all your metabolism is decided by them. So that's why what vayu, what air element, what effect it has, one needs to know. I'm just explaining one air element called a Dhananjaya. The story of the Dhananjaya. So this Vishakha, at the age of 7 years, she got enlightened and she is the one who lived 125 years. Mahakashyapa, and she is the one. And by the time, and her family grew to become, you know, she had 100 daughters, 100 children of herself. These 100 children in turn, 100, so many. By the time, at the age of 125 years, and you know, so she had no disease, no suffering. She is very active, very, very active. She constructed a big monastery, Pubbharama monastery for Buddha. And Buddha said, I am not interested. You want to construct, you construct. So in the same Shravasti, because and when she got married, she has to go from one kingdom to the other kingdom. And in another kingdom, so her father-in-law follows different meditation tradition, but she is so intelligent enough. And you know, so she changed her father-in-law and tradition, and you know, so she became Buddha devotee. And all her family followed, and she is in the capital city of the Kosala kingdom. And one side you will find a Jetavana monastery constructed by the billionaire Anathapindika. Exactly opposite side, other side you will find a monastery devoted to the Buddha and constructed by Mother Vishakha. So there's so much to. It's not that I'm explaining about Buddha or anything, because in relevance to some topic when it comes to what is the Himalayan tradition and what is DNA memory, what is the Yak memory, what is the DNA memory, how is the DNA memory, now again how it can be created and what were the technologies, why the relics are preserved in India and a person is an enlightened, and so that relic, it is not that you should take the relic and merge in the Ganges, you should keep it. If that person is not enlightened, if that person is bad, it's good, bad keeping that relic in your house, that's why you have to go and take it and merge in the Ganges. But for sure you know, and he is the greatest person, he doesn't have any negative quality, means he must be a yogi. To keep that relic in your house forever, he has to be a yogi. That's why if at all if you get a yogi relic, you should never leave it, you should eternally preserve it at home. That's how every yogi, like Buddha's relic, or every arahant, every enlightened person, relics are preserved. So that because they are the power and they protect the environment around you, and they are the carries legacy. That is a yoga tradition. And what is the hair? And all these astronauts after 6 months living in that simulator, and they will analyze the hair and they will know, oh, so with their psychological status, emotional status, and then they will decide if they could and very successfully finish the training program in the simulator. And their emotional compatibility, emotional strength, and everything you checked. And then they will be sent to the Mars. The main test is called hair test. Not only that, The only hair metal test called HMT, the hair metal test is only the way to know any DNA related problems for your child. In fact, am I going to get Alzheimer's, am I going to get dementia, am I going to get the Parkinson's will be known. And each one of us, we must get done the test called, especially if you are in the West, you should get done HMT hair metal test. In the nutrigenomics, now the nutrition related, by nutrition, how you can cure, how you can methylate a DNA and how you can cure the problem, you will know. And where to methylate, how to methylate, if you use, you must carry on. Even for your children, you should carry HMT test, the hair metal test. Because your hair represents the entire, any poisonous chemicals are there, good chemicals are there. As I told you, everything it indicates. That's why hair is given so much importance in India. If you go to Africa, there are so many hairstyles. In India, so many hairstyles. They grow the hair. And that's why Kesha Karma, grooming the hair, is a method, there is a science behind it. Who is supposed to grow hair? Who is supposed to fold the hair in a particular fashion? Who is supposed to shave in the head, shave the head? Everything is systematically, highly scientifically. Today you are talking about, oh my God, it is a hair metal test will tell your entire DNA. And you know, now, oh my God, and you know, the one who is going to the, you know, astronaut, and his hair sample is collected. Does it mean if you do not know, it means you won't believe it. You say, hey, it's all useless. And now the same useless thing today, you say, what a great legacy. First of all, you should understand, when you come to in India, when you are born in India, and every culture in India, I tell you, it is highly evolved scientific. The present science is not sufficient enough to know the depth of the science given by a saint. Not possible, impossible. For you to appreciate, you have to become a yogi like me. I can tell you. Then you will understand the depth of the science, which has become a routine for an ordinary Indian to lead their life. And today, the dummy Indians, they don't realize. They emulate the Western culture. And they grow the hair, and they go to the gurus growing the hair. Are you going for what? Already you are earning money, and already what for you are going for these techniques? Again, for experience. You should seek, you should know that the legacy is a shaven head. Shaven heads. The legacy of India, Vedic culture means shaven head. You are growing the hair means not allowed for a brand, not allowed for anyone. It indicates your laziness today. It's so shabby to see, having come from, you know, if anyone says, I have seen one day Kumar with the hair, beard. Yes, when my father passed away, I should not shave. But after he passed away, after the 10th day, I would shave my head. And I removed my mustache in memory of my father passed away. The day, because there is certain things which you have to do. And the reason why, till then I had a mustache. Mustache is allowed, not the beard. But even that mustache I removed because my father passing away shows I have to come to that level of maturity. I am matured enough. That's the reason I have to renounce and hair. So that day onward, there is no more mustache. I'm telling my wife, I'm not sure where tomorrow my mother goes away. Maybe I start shaving my head. Understand, our culture is not growing. Not growing the karma, not growing the wealth, not growing the memories. Our culture is clean. Indian culture, yoga means yogam atma vishuddhaye. It is all cleaning, cleaning, cleaning. It is the dummies, it is the lazies, it is the people with inertia grow hair. And present generation, you can see how lazy these people are. So they have, you can see the inertia in them. There is no act, there is no chetana, there is no active, there is no participation. All the time it is like, you know, drug addicts, all the time sitting, sleeping, and lethargy, lazy for everything, you know, oh my God, I have to go now, procrastination, you know, the postponement, delay, negative thinking. This is the present generation. Why? Because far away, the parents have not them the culture, because parents, they don't have the culture. They never know what is the culture. The damage is, why the present generation? Because parents made them as a money earning mongering. You know? The present generation, the parents, all the time, they are least bothered about the culture. They are all the bothered about, my child should earn more money. That is the wound, is the thing which shattered entirely. And today, India is, forget about India as a spiritual country. I'm telling you. India today is a highly materialistic, and it is aiming to number one materialistic country. That's why don't think all these engineers and all Indians are going to be. No. They love now the gold, they love the plots, they love the vehicles, they love the materialistic things than anywhere. Now I see a lot of hierarchy in the West, but in India, everyone loves possessions. Everyone loves the rich watches, and everyone loves the bikes, and everyone loves the cars, everyone loves the plots, everyone loves the status and their name. And as a parents, what we are doing is only growing this culture among our children. Our children are going to be further end up in a mess. The West realized very quickly in 1970s, 80s, oh my God, and this materialism and all the things are good, damaging, and you know, all lifestyle diseases, and it is happening, we are getting killed. That's why they started adoring yoga. They started practicing yoga. That's how Krishnamacharya, Iyengar, Pattabhiraj became so famous in abroad. They're not even known in India. And in India, and now what happened in 1970s and 80s and 90s in abroad, now in India, money. And we are, and now with the result, indulgence in the money, indulgence in the comforts, and what happened? Now that there's no house free from the diabetes in India. There's no house free from, you know, free from hypertension. There's no house. You name, you tell me one house in India. One house where grandparents to your, you know, where your grandparents to your siblings, one free from the disease. One house. So what legacy we create? A total health to, a total demolish. And we take pride. India is growing. India is growing towards killing itself, because cultural suicidal, genocidal, and cultural suicide is called a genocide. What we have done? Why it happened? Because we learned English, and you know, I want my child to be educated only in English. God, I want the materialistic pursuit. What a Gotra has given, what a mockery of the spirituality today. Even these youngsters go for getting visa, they visit the temple. They go around the temple. If I go around the temple like this, I will get visa. If I go around the temple, you know, I will get, I will pass out my examination. They will remember God only when there is examination, when there is a trouble. You know, as soon as examination is over, which temple, which movie theater I should go, which pub I should go, which restaurant I should go. Before examination, which temple I should go. As soon as examination is over, and which pub I should go, which restaurant I should indulge. As soon as the examination, let me express my gratitude to the God, you know. No. Every Indian, I am telling today, before examination, if you are a Christian, you go to the church. If you are a Muslim, you go to the mosque. And if you are a Hindu, you go to the temple. Oh my God, let me pass. Hey God, kindly help me to pass examination. And as soon as exams are over, not even results, exams are over. And as if God wished them to be in the restaurant and the movie theater, you should see the last day of examination, you should see all theaters are full. All restaurants are full. All temples are empty. Before examination, before academic year begins, you should see in India, all temples are full. At the end of the academic years, no temple is full because all of them are in Swiss, Alps, summer trips, pilgrimages. Before examinations, all temples full. After examinations, all temples empty. This is what we are teaching our children. What we are teaching? God means a wish fulfiller. Means you should make choices, not choiceless. Unlike any other species, we train our children. God means only you have to go with the wish. And don't acknowledge as soon as the wish is, you know, that a wish has to be there. But, you know, don't express any gratitude. As soon as it is over, you can postpone. And you tell the God, you know, so if I pass out, I will come back to you, God. You know, in terms of thank you, I will give my hair because it comes for free. Or, you know, I give you something, a penny or candy, I will give you, they promise. And after the examination is over, oh my God, now is not the right time, God. I will come after 1 month. And after 1 month, no, it's not right time, God. I will come after 2 months. And 6 months, 7 months. And they accumulate. After 10 years, oh my God, that was pending, you know. And God also should keep you, your wishes pending. Why he should process them? To whom you are making mockery? This is the Indian worship in the gods now. This is the Indian devotion now. And are you practicing the same devotion in the West also? This is not yoga. This is not spirituality. Now today, you name any Indian home, but this is the spirituality. Where is the spirituality? Spirituality dead already. It is all very, even in the name of yoga universities, what they teach, a mantra, the bead, all, they have not studied in any monasteries. Dead. If you examine the present yoga syllabus, and is it written by a yogis? No. So this is a way, there is no more yoga legacy survives. Yoga has to be taught, not a name seeking, name mongering, attention seeking, and intellectual scholarization. Why I have to prove that, you know, inhaling from right nostril will cure your problem? Why I have to go in the laboratory and why I have to participate? Now this craziness is going. Every technique of yoga has to be proven. And for thousands of years a technique is proven. And now you want to prove it in a laboratory test and some small test you will do. Oh, I found, you know, this breathing technique is helpful. You publish a paper. Then only the technique should be practiced. Have you gone insane? Today you want to do researching in yoga or you want experience? Yoga is experiential, not research. A yogi already researched it, already at the level of yogi discovered something. Now in the name of the, you are ruining the yoga, you are changing the method of practice in the name of experimentation. Is it correct? It's not correct. Because to whom you are questioning? You are questioning Vasishtha, you are questioning Bharadwaja, you are questioning them, and today you will make, you have to practice yoga like this. Can anyone tell like this? Can anyone tell like this? Yoga is a dynamic in its approach. Individually distinct constitutional type personality. That's how the yoga has to be learned as a holistic. No one can tell you yoga, you have to practice this asana first, second asana like this, third asana like this. How come? That is a wrong way of doing it. This is how now non-yogi is practicing yoga and, you know, killing yoga, and it's happened. We should be very, very careful. Why? Because I represent the traditions. I'm talking about those saints. And whatever I am telling you comes from thousands of years the legacy. We are not here to make mockery of it. We are here to uphold, because that is going to protect. And every breathing technique manipulated, branded, and you people are encouraging you to, one side you say it should not be branded, but why you are going after the brand? Why you are promoting a brand? A yoga technique of concentration here, Shambhavi Mudra, why you should be encouraging a particular brand? And everyone should practice. And it's only one. There are so many mudras, Kecharya mudra, and so many thousands of mudras are there. Are you sure that mudra is, oh, Why you are promoting a brand? And another one teaches one particular breathing technique and again patenting. Have we gone insane in yoga like this? Can't it be given? And you should teach entire yoga and one among the mudras, one mudra costs that much, means if I teach you 100 mudras, how much it would cost you? And one breathing technique you are paying for $800 or, you know, $20, $30 for one technique. Then I know all the techniques, how much you should pay? You are like a fool. And especially why I tell you? Because you are promoting a brand. Never promote a brand. Yoga is brandless. Yoga carries only one brand called Yogi's brand. Yogi's brand doesn't carry any name. Never call your yoga by your guru's name. Guru name is different. He is only a messenger. And never call it Kumar Yoga. That is our, that's how an ignorant person talks. You should only call it traditional yoga. We are here to uphold the legacy of the traditions. Kumar as an individual has absolutely no meaning. That's why you should never worship as a Kumar. No question of Kumar. And what Kumar teaches is important. And all the credit goes to all those saints. So yoga has to be kshuraha. It is the akshara, kshuraha. It is to cut, clean. Yoga is the entire thing to clean, 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 clean. Always understand the areas which should not be cleaned. The hair where it should not be cleaned. What is the pubic hair? It should not be cleaned in yoga traditions. Whether you are a male or a female. Pubic hair should not be touched because it protects you from virus. It's a powerful electrostatic fiber given to the god. No coronavirus enters. The hair in the nose should not be cut. Inside the nose. Because it arrests the particles. Oh, the nose, under the nose should be cut. You can trim it, but should not shave. You should shave this. External hair you should shave, but not internal hair you should not shave. Because internal hair protects you. The hair here, it can be cut. The hair here should not be cut. Pubic hair should not be cut. Because if you have a pubic hair, you will not get any urinary diseases. You will not get any. So many diseases come from this root. The best way to protect it. That's why hair grows there. And the hair follicle there is very, very small size than this hair. The smallest diameter hair in your body is grown only here. Because that is a size, fiber size that will decide, that will protect you from the virus, that will protect you from all that. Now when you use the wool, why we use the wool is nothing but a hair having electrostatic property. And the wool, the yak carries the wool. Yak wool is very, very famous. Very, very famous. So understand, for everything there is a science behind it. I will talk about shaving brush, what standard, which hair. If you want to know, that also I will tell you. That's not a problem. You know. But for everything there is a pramana, there is a standard. Not many people know which shaving brush they should use, what hair shaving brush should have. Now all present synthetic nylon. You have to either use a shaving brush of the, you know, boar or a bear hair, or the best is called badger. And badger hair, badger silver tips is the best, you know. So a shaving brush hair, you should know. Badger silver tips. Because you do not know, you are not asking for it. That's called a brush for lifetime. Anything protects your body, it is not a decorate. Anything that protects your body to facilitates to purify the soul, you must go for it. Anything that doesn't facilitate, that anything that keeps you healthy, clean, you must go for it. There is no doubt about that. But for that you have to go by pramana. It is not for a decorative means. When I am telling you something, it has no meaning of decorative purpose. I am not telling from the point of indulgence. I am telling from the point of standard. So that you don't have to go on buying, because your hair, if it is not shaven properly, again, it has no meaning. You know, and your skin is damaging because you are using a wrong brush. a wrong blade means then you are damaging. That's why in yoga, every Shuddhi Karma, this comes under Dauti practices. All these are cleaning practices. In yoga, first limb is only this. You know, so when to clean, when to cut, how to clean, how to cut the nail. All this is the part of the yoga. First things to be learned in yoga are only this. Like a toilet training, like a mat training. Other day I was showing it to you. Shuddhi Kriya, how to drink the water. And drinking the water and taking out from the nose, not from the mouth. And drinking the water into the abdomen and taking out from the mouth. If you drink water to the stomach and take out, it should be taken out from the mouth. If you drink the water to the throat, and it should be taken out from the nose. So that it cleanses the entire upper throat in way. Especially now it is a COVID period. We should do that Shit Krama Bastrika. And number two is, always keep 5 clothes. I tell you, clothes alone will protect you from COVID virus. Prevent, not as a cure, but I tell you, so next 2 years at least, morning to night, grade 1 clothes. Always keep 5 clothes in your mouth. Because that cloth and gradually secretes and eugenol. And eugenol is a powerful antivirus. And it clears, you will never get cold. And you know, so your throat will be clear. Always follow the science. So lavang and cloves. Which cloves? And the clove you should use should be grade 1. And 8 mm cloves. Grade 1. And virgin. And forest. Grounds. Like from Kerala. Like Madagascar. Madagascar cloves are best. One clove is Madagascar clove, 2 cloves enough. Indian, Kerala cloves, 4 cloves. And grade C, and 20 grams, even you keep, it won't have the equivalent 4 cloves, antioxidant activity. Oil removed cloves, not good. Understand? Or clove, but oil. The most powerful oil is clove oil. Most powerful. In fact, in your vaporizer oil, I have not used the clove bud oil because it's very, very powerful, very, very pungent. You can add, if you added all the oil, say 5 ml, 10 ml, if you have in 1 liter you can add 5 ml. And it will have protection. Morning to evening, you will have protection. Morning to evening, no mosquito will bite. That powerful the clove bud oil is. You know. And the same vaporizer oil, whichever I have prepared. So like this, you add another additional called clove bud oil, 5 ml you add. And so cinnamon and all having antiviral properties. The thing is, also understand, apply. Entire body apply the vaporizer oil. Apply entire body, including the face. It burns, but it is highly, don't use an exfoliating scrub for your face. Don't use exfoliation means penetration and removing, purification. Exfoliation is the purification deep under the keratin and from the epidermis layer cleansing is called exfoliation. And vaporizer oil is the best exfoliating oil. Using Visavis exfoliating scrub versus exfoliating oil is the best. Even after shave, and it burns, but use and vaporizer oil. And it costs, because it purifies your entire skin deep down, at least 3 mm to 4 mm of the skin penetration happens, and that pain, that inflammatory response, and leads to a lot of purification. It is more powerful than a sauna, more powerful than, you know, high temperature, and you know, so called, you know, thermic exposure, or It is more powerful than hot water bath and more powerful than an exfoliating scrub. As soon as you bathe, apply morning and evening entire body exfoliating oil. It burns your skin. Burns means it causes like pins and needles, like penetrate. You can virtually see sweat comes out. And where your penetrating oil is working or not, you will know. And sweat comes out. Entire body as if you bathed. That is the action of the exfoliation of the oil. And then after a while, and you will find entire body becomes super light. That kind of the purification. And it happened. Experiment it. Yoga is all about what Guru tells. And you have to experience it. Experience it. So, experience. Because this will protect you when you are going out now, post-lockdown. Because your body, you may be thinking your clothes won't protect you. Your simply protection here doesn't mean anything. Now COVID virus can go anywhere, even through the fecal matter, even through the sewage, even through the smell. The best way is, you can't wear the silk cloth all around you. That's right. Just apply this vaporizer oil, add Clobud oil, because it increases its antiviral duration. Almost 3 to 4 hours, 4 to 5 hours it will keep. So that's why add a little bit of Clobud oil and then apply to entire body morning and evening, even for your children apply, because the children will play and so they are out in the dust and so you are protecting. That is the best protection now, post-lockdown period, once you start, because already in India and so already we started going to the offices. Now I see a lot of traffic on the road and pollution started, and every pollution is the best way to spread the COVID virus. And already we can see how the COVID virus is increasing in India, and this is the time to protect ourselves. That's why I'm telling you, use an exfoliating, not exfoliating scrub, but exfoliating oil. And the oil which I have given you has a multi-purpose utility, and including the pain it will remove, but entire body massage it, and you should endure that pain. But that pain is good. That engineered pain is very good. And that exfoliation, what it causes, because it purifies underneath the skin, so that you will never get skin cancer, you will never get, so your sweat pores will be open, you are activating the sweat pores, your evaporation losses are very good, so it cools down the body, because it's a summer season, and exfoliation with the oil helps. And the sweat comes out, the moment you apply the sweat comes out, you feel you are cool. So that is the best way to remove the heat from inside. So that is by radiation, evaporation. So both the ways it helps. Understand? So today, I think, so every day is going. So we practice breathing technique. So little bit breathing technique. I was explaining about. So there are many concepts to be explained, and when I start explaining, so it has to be understood by you, not by me. It is not like, simply one sentence I tell you. What you will carry forward, tell me. You open Mahabharata, you open Ramayana, you open Ulysses. Why you remember? Why they remain for thousands of years? Because everything explained in the form of a story. So when you want to hear a story, you tell, hey, tell me only story in 1 minute. Do you tell? Hey, grandma, tell me story. So as a child, so if you are a child, now the present generation child, no grandmother. They want to, hey, mom, give me WhatsApp, give me, some mobile phone. Now the grandchildren, grandmother is mobile phone. So that's why I think they kept, so more. So they know the word more, mobile, oh mobile, please tell me Google, yes my dear kid, and now tell me a story, which story you want, I want some story, and now Google will start, Google Assistant will tell you the story, and the child will be listening, because grandmothers do not know now the stories, parents themselves do not know, grandmothers do not know, because grandmothers engaged in the super mall, and mothers engaged in the McDonald's restaurant. And so the children are engaged in the mobile. The present generation, where is the time? There is no time for the grandmothers, there is no time for the my parents. That's why kids, so story, So they go beyond story for sure. You know, the kids don't stop. First Google Assistant, they ask the story because they're thinking mom will tell, you know. So listen to the Google, you know, why do I'm not a good storyteller, I do not know. So listen, Google Assistant will tell you the children's stories very well. And you know, child start listening to the story, meanwhile one advertisement crops up there, you know. Because the Google Map artificial intelligence, is the child who is watching it, and one nice, you know, so a toy comes there. And now the child forgets about the story. Now he strikes on the button of the oh my God, you know, it looks like a Donald, it's like a Mickey, you know, it's like attention deficiency syndrome, you know, attention diverting syndrome begins in the child. This is what happening. When this is happening to you, and why it doesn't happen to your kid? This is the same thing happening. You open internet for something, and something comes out, you want to search something, you end up searching something. And you end up probing something else. So when you have attention deficiency syndrome, and how come and a kid will have attention focus syndrome? That's why the legacy is Ramayana or anything is storytelling. Because what you will remember, what programs the brain, now the neural research shows, and it is all, the learning takes place only when you create more number of moment of interests. Entire my gurus, why I am telling you, why, how I could remember all this knowledge, and because my gurus are very good in creating moments of interest story. Anything that goes into the shapes your brain, and that brain is called a powerful brain. And that brain is called, so what's its name? Limbic system. The most powerful part in your system, in your brain, is called limbic system. It's hypothalamus, hippocampus, amygdala. You know, the area of emotions and feelings is called limbic system. And to train limbic system positive way, all that is your limbic system, which controls your limbs to function, to drive you towards the singularity or to drive you towards the restaurant, is decided by limbic system. And present generation is using only the limbic system. And this limbic system, if you engage, the only way you can program is by moment of interest, storytelling. That's why in entire India, my mother taught me so many stories. And story, now the corporates are telling, you have to, and anything you want to convey to your subordinates, down the level, information to be flowed down in the form of a story. In the form of a story. But this is a discovery of India. It is not a discovery. The real stories. Why am I telling every day some story or the other coming out? Because that's the way I am programming your brain, your neural circuits. That the moments of interest will lead to neural coupling. Means you will have similar thinking. Develop, your brain develops. Same memory area, same cognitive abilities. Guru is programming. It's called neural coupling. What Kumari is teaching, the method of teaching of the saint is neural coupling, moment of interest. And in 1 minute, how the moment of interest can be, bad moment of interest can be created. That is called advertisement. That the negative moments of interest, negative, positive. A guru is creating a Ramayana, Mahabharata, Ulysses, creates a positive moments of interest. They shape your personality, behavioral traits, and they shape your limbic system positive way. But there is a negative way to influence it. They are called modern ads. A negative way, it won't take 2 hours to shape. Negative way will influence you in 1 minute enough. 30 seconds enough. Marlboro, and advertisement of the cigarettes. Now today, all males smoke cigarettes. Just one advertisement. And that's why, and the one who is watching the advertisement is a fool. You know, because in 10 seconds, That advertisement, your limbic system is programmed. So your limbs walk towards, you have seen your favorite hero drinking some beverage and you like a fool and you know thinking you are not a hero, he is a billionaire, you are a pauper and you know, so you have only 1 pound in your pocket and drinking that and that 1 pound in you, you go like sheep behind him. You won't go behind Kumar like a saint to the Himalaya, but for sure that influence, you know, the moment you see that advertisement, you go behind the restaurant. And you end up 10 seconds, your entire limbs walk to, made you to walk. And now I see in India, a jewelry shop. And you know, so there is a gun, you know, he comes with a shaven head, you know, one person. And he talks about, you know, this is the best jewelry. You know. Now shaven heads are used for selling the jewelry now in India, you know. And because they earn more respect. And now, so he will tell, you know, in my shop, jewelry is a pramana standard. And, now I see the 10 seconds or 20 seconds influence, I tell you. And so when my family is selling, and the jewelry shop is so big like a palace, but there is no place to enter. And like COVID virus, you know, essential supplies, people are like in front of the wine shops, people are, you know, so in line queues. It seems one particular auspicious day when they went, and all the big lines for buying gold. Because of the magic, because of the power of advertisement, power of package, power of selling, and on your network. So what flashes? You want advertisement free, it is expensive. And if you want advertisement, it's free, even free. Is it free? Which is more expensive, tell me. You are like a fool, opt for, you know, so, why should I pay advertisement free content? And let me have advertisements, what does it matter? Okay, so you are going for advertisements. Do you know what happens? This is going to be very, very expensive. If you have a wisdom and if anyone is selling you some content, advertisement free, you buy, pay for 1 pound and you are ending with only 1 pound. Otherwise, I am telling you, you end up paying 10 pounds or 100 pounds. Because you are a slave of that advertisement. That advertisement is programmed by psychologists, programmed by behavioral scientists, and programmed by artificial intelligence, and they know you, they know your limbic system so well. You do not know any way limbic system. You know, Kumar is trying to educate you, are not interested what to do. And you know, so this limbic, they know your limbic system, how to drive your limbs, they know very well. And a cinema director knows when to make you laugh. And you know, when he expected you to laugh, you laugh in the movie. And he knows when to generate testosterone in you, the hero-heroine romance. And you also like foolish, and you know, without hero beside you, without heroine, foolish, and you also generate testosterone or estrogen here, sitting in the theater without anyone around you, watching there. And he wants you to generate fear in you. And oh my God, and you're sitting in the theater, in the seat, you also, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, nothing is happening. You can see all the emotions in you. And then when he wants to create, you know, excitement in you, oh my God, and their hero is on the cliff, hero is walking on the rope, as if you are walking on the rope, here you are in the tension. So that is what, that emotion, that fear, that adrenaline, he wanted to pump in you, and we like a stupids. You know, just sitting here in the chair and we generate all those emotions buying that content. And what is that? So he made you fool, he made you slave. Entire movie, your loving for movie is you are a slave of even Spielberg or you know, Steven Spielberg or some famous director. Simply you are a slave. Because he wants to create that expression, that emotion, whatever the desired emotion he wants to see in you. And you will exhibit the same emotion. Means you do not know about your emotion. Your emotion is controlled by scriptwriter, director, cameraman, director. That's why I am telling you, don't become slave, don't watch those. And hey, Mr. Kumar, I don't watch your program, but I will watch only those programs. That's why I said we are programmed to be slaves, programmed to be a robot. Let us understand this program. Patanjali is saying it is the program to decondition the mind. It is not to program the mind. So storytelling, what you are hearing, because this, if you are hearing, you know, see, if you are hearing, for sure, it shapes the way it is. It shapes, you know. It shapes. So practicing pranayama. So how? Yesterday we practiced. So problem is, yes, as Kumar starts speaking, explaining one story to the other. So just to give you one, understand, it is a must. So, but we will also practice. You have to have a patience to learn from a teacher like a Kumar. Because what you get is, your brain is shaping, getting shaped. That is only the way to shape your brain. It is not just about the body. Inhaling. This is called inhalation. Every inhalation, your entire body you are inhaling, and your heart pumps everywhere. That's why it's called pranaya swaha. Prana means inhaling. Your heart is the center for the prana, udhana. Udhana means it is for this entire your head region is called udhana, clavicular region, and samana you call your digestive. Apana, the two apanas, one is excretory and one is your reproductive, which flows downward is called apana. And fire, samana, digestive system. And your air element is called prana. And then you go up, nervous system, nervous element is called, and so called udhana. And central nervous system, every cell and controlled by called vyana. So all these are to be exhaled. So inhaling is a prana. So your heart pumping everywhere. Then, and it is an efferent communication from every cell. It has to go up. Every cell we are purifying. And exhalation is from different parts. But inhalation is from the heart. That's what. And inhalation mode is only heart to every cell. But exhalation is cell to back to lungs. Every cell. That's why, so all these are exhalation. Om apanaya swaha, om samanaya swaha, om udhanaya swaha, om vyanaya swaha. That is exhalation, pranayama. Om pranaya swaha. When I say like that, inhale. When you inhale, stage wise inhale. Or inhale. Inhale, your chest upright in the front, like this, you see. Pranayama swaha. Pranayama swaha. Pranayama swaha. Pranayama swaha. Your chest clavicle should be upright. Observe my shoulders where they are and my chest upright. Chest cavity is full. You can see that, you should experience it. Pranaya, filling in different direction. Pranaya. 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 All these are for every pranayama, for apanaya. Apanaya is this. Pranaya. When I say apana, om apanaya swaha. Exhaling from down. Next apana. And here, and when I say pranaya swaha, apana. Om apanai from genitals. Om apanai swaha. Either you say this or join your hand. This is a mudra. Go like it. Say this. Say this. This is what called swaha. Swaha, 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 swaha. This is the way, this is the mudra. Anghaniyasa. When you inhale, inhale. Come, come, come. It is all inhale. Come, come. It is all. Inhaling, exhaling, sama apanaya, two apanaya, samanaya, digest this. Samanaya swaha, samanaya swaha. When you exhale, keep your attention here in your stomach. And your hands automatically decides that your lungs, your muscles involved at this level. Similarly, and when you say udhana, prana is here, you don't have to worry. And udhana means here, this region, this, this region. Traditional Sandhya Vandana. So this is the way to do it, with the breath. So everything in the Sandhya Vandana has with the breath. So there are the steps in Sandhya Vandana. So beginning with Uttishtanta Bhuta Pishacha Yete Bhumi Bharaka. That we will come later. Om Keshavaya Swaha. Om Govinda. All these are ashmana means purifying and cleaning, cleansing, bathing. That's called ashmana. And these are the part of the sanjhavana. Okay. So these are the pranayamas which must be practiced every day. So this, any time, morning and evening auspicious, mean transcending time. So that, and any time you can do this, you feel very good. This is the fundamental pranayama. Then, having done this, so you have to couple with external making forced exhalation, Shakti Chalapa. Internal respiratory techniques means making your residual volume zero, forced exhalation, like in Tibetan box breathing we have done in pranayama. They are highly energizing, and that we do like this. Inhaling like this. Inhale. And rapid exhalation. Slow inhalation. Inhale, filling your lungs. Hold upward. Once you hold, fill your cavity. Once you fill it, and then at once throw it out. Because the deep down at the diaphragmatic level should count. And you also should know one thing. As I told you, lungs are divided into three. Superior, medial and lower lobes. But you should know, your left lung, left side you have only two lobes. And right side you have three lobes. Means left side, the size of the lobes is almost the same. But, of course, little less on the left side. Your lungs volume is little less. The lung size, physical size is little less on the left side. More on the right side. Understand that. And the left side. So the left side lungs only you have two lobes. And medial lobe, it is as good as it doesn't exist. So the major medial lobe, so only superior lobe and inferior lobe on the left lung, left side of the rib cage. And the major one is located on the back. And the superior lobe is situated in the front, major part. That's the left side. Right side you have three demarcated lobes. Why in the left side? Because the tip of your heart, though it is in the center, your heart is looks like reclined. Your heart is positioned exactly, you know, down the pectoralis here. But here, it is the tip. So the tip is oriented toward the left. So it has to have a time to move. So it has to have a space to move front and back. That's why the God has created the left side. There's some space for your heart to beat. Because the tip of the heart, as I told you, heart doesn't expand like this. Heart goes like this. Heart goes like this. So that expansion, it goes. So heart goes up like this. So it has to have a space to go into clavicular and intercostal region, your lung. And the tip of the heart is oriented toward, not to the right, toward the left. That's how we sense the heartbeat on the left side. Though the heart is in the center, but we sense the heartbeat here, in the left side. Why? Because your heart edge, your left ventricle, that which pumps to entire body, which is the thick portion, and thick portion is this side. Heart is here. But when it expanding, when it is contracting, expanding, you will only sense the tip. So to allow that expansion and contraction of superior lobe of the heart, so the God has created your respiratory system accordingly. There are only two lobes He has given on the left side. On the right side He has given three lobes. So that's the reason you should know the finest of the differences when you are inhaling and why we are moving like this, why we move like this. And when you inhale from the left nostril, it goes to the left. When you go inhale right, directing. And as you know, why nostrils are given left or right? 5,000 kinds of receptors in your nostril. 5,000. Each receptor smells only one kind of the smell. And human brain, the 5,000 smells, it can convert into 100,000 smells. What a human brain, when every memory acquired from the sense doors, and that memory, your smell memory is created with every memory, smell memory. Not like these videos, only sound memory, only visual memory it is creating. Any audio video recording. Understand? But your hardware and stores all the six memories. The memory of the eye, memory of the ear, memory of the nose, memory of the tongue, memory of the mind, memory of the skin. Simultaneously, all these memory, a chitta, a memory, DNA memory created, means your chemicals released is nothing but that chemical stream released is the input capture. captured by all these devices. Camera doesn't have ears. It has ears, it has eyes, but it is a camera doesn't have a nose, camera doesn't have mouth, and camera doesn't have, you know, so the video camera, they don't have skin. Understand? So the camera has only two things. It has only eyes, it has only ears. But we are more powerful than these, any of these gadgets, because we have more capturing. Our storing of the information is and much more deeper. Why am I telling you? Whatever you hear, whatever you smell, and why left nostril, why Krishna is telling, no inside, the 5,000 smells, you are sensitive to the smell means what? You should be able to distinctly categorize 5,000 smells. Not only that, and further sensitivity means you should be, 5,000 smells are not 5,000, like three colors, and you know, you can create thousands of the colors. The principal colors, primary colors are only three. Similarly, if the primary smells are only 5,000, but your brain can create 100,000 smells. When a yogi is sensitive, means he is sensitive to 100,000 smells. A god's smell, angel's smell, a flower smell. And you can see the dog. It can isolate, and now the dogs are trained to find who affected with the cancer. You know, a dog has so much of sensitivity, and because its receptors are very, very active, it can distinguish between a cancer patient and non-cancer patient. If you just have to train it, that's all. A dog can find out deep down buried mines, bombs, RDX, it can find out. And we have come from that family, but we are involving this nose in the grass smells, that's why, and our sensitivity has come down. So when you do yoga, and my student, you know, so he came for meditation, and he's observing the breath inside. He lost the smell, you know, so long back, 15, 20 years back, and again he regained, and he smelled back, because the moment you start observing inside, the activating of these smell receptors happens. They are called olfactory receptors. Olfactory receptors, 5,000 receptors. And these 5,000 receptors connected to the limbic system. And the electric pulse goes and processed by the cortex and goes into the limbic system. And the information, the memory, and it goes, from there it goes into the rest of the body, into the DNA. The information pathway from your nose, very well understood, very well explored. And when you are inhaling from right, actually it goes to the right. And it goes, when you are inhaling from the left, breath goes to the left brain only. Suppose left nostril is blocked, then right brain it goes to. But I am not talking about flow of the information, flow of the breath. I am talking about flow of information. When I say left nostril is connected to the right brain, it is a flow of information, process of concentration, and process of, that is a space and time dimension, it is consciousness dimension, not the physical dimension of the air element. So physical air element, when you take from the left nostril, it goes to only left. And when it goes from the right, it goes to the right. If the left nostril is blocked, and your right nostril takes over, right brain takes over. Understand that. So medial brain takes lateral brain and medial brain. So actually your lateral brain functions. But in case your lateral brain is not functioning, then medial brain will take over. The medial brain part will take over. So that's why the left nostril, right nostril is a forced exhalation. And it's emptying out the lungs completely. So when you go... Inhale. Inhale. So inhale. Ha. Exhale. Inhale. So so slowly, that much duration you inhale. When you say ha, the way I am chanting, that is a typical mantra bijakshara say. Ham is a bijakshara, very powerful. Ham is a word here. It is a yam, it is a ha. That's why, and it is a ha. It is called so ham, is used for, and this. So inhale, fill, ha, ha, exhale, force it, it's like that. The muscles involved, like a shoulder press, you don't need a 100 kg weight, it's more powerful than a shoulder press. Why? Speed. In your shoulder press, speed is not a dummy exercise, but this is powerful. It's like a Bruce Lee. You look at my arms, how it goes. Agility. Three directions. Principal direction. These are the main directions. Inhalation, exhalation, rapid. Soha, Shakti Chalana Bastrika means forced expulsion, making, and forced expulsion means CO2 regulation, means pumping in more oxygen. More oxygen to every limb in your, every cell in your body. And emptying out the lung means, again when you inhale, your tidal volume, 6 liters you should be able to fill in your chest. Once again, so Respiratory system. Slow breathing means filling tidal volume, pumping into your hands, lifting the muscles, intrinsic, extrinsic, clavicular, intercostal, diaphragmatic, every muscle involved, including scapula, rhomboid, inferior trapezius, middle trapezius, upper trapezius, clavicles, pectoralis, major, minor, all the limbs of the deltoid and thoracic muscle, all the thoracic muscles involved. Then there's a way to pump in oxygen, there's a way to pump blood, and there's a way to pump oxygen. Blood and oxygen equally available across the breadth and the length of the lungs, and you are healthy and you are happy. The whole objective is this. These are very powerful. Fourthly, expiration, making your residual volume zero, again making the tidal volume. So that balance. Making expiratory volume zero is achieved by internal respiratory techniques, internal respiratory system, external respiratory system, internal respiratory system. Internal respiratory techniques are all forced exhalation, short expulsions, short inhalations, short exhalation. Anything that is short, anything that is fast is called internal respiration. Anything that is slow, anything that is slow, anything that is lengthy, long, and that is called external respiratory system. And all the balance of pranayama is about balancing between internal and external. Internal respiratory system means filling oxygen in the blood. External respiratory system means an anabolic action. And internal respiratory system means it is catabolic action. Anabolic action is external respiration. You burn entire ATP generated, and internally whatever generated, again when you inhale, you supply the oxygen, you break down your fat, you break down, you consume carbohydrate, you consume everything, and to produce ATP and to strengthen your mitochondrial. Your mitochondrial number increases only when there is a forced expiration. That's why, and we again do anaerobic, not anaerobic, forced expiration means making your residual volume zero. Residual volume zero means ATP making zero. So anabolic action consumes entire ATP generated. Unless ATP generated, consumed, another ATP cannot be generated. So catabolism, anabolism, metabolism, and breath is to regulate the metabolism. Cellular body, where is the metabolism descended? The cell, astral body, pranamaya kosha. There's a reason and why every external breathing technique has to be followed by internal breathing techniques to balance. It is not that you only inhale slowly, exhale slowly. No, because when you have a residual value very high, like for example, BKS Iyengar rib cage indicates thick, means it is indicating high volumes of the residual value. It indicates he did not practice enough of forced expiration, forced inhalation. He did not practice simple. He only practiced inhalation with the result. And when your residual volume is increasing, and when you on the top, when you are pumping in your tidal volume, your rib cage swells. That is, and in both the cases you will find, even in Pattabhi Jaya's case also you will find. But whereas in Krishnamacharya you find his rib cage is absolutely perfect. Looking at your rib cage itself, one can try whether you have done wrong pranayama or better pranayama. I see so many people, 75-year-old, 80-year-old, and they say, oh, we have been practicing home meditation. And when I look at their lungs, so weak. Totally wrong way they practice. Understand? Just don't go by, oh, he's 75-year-old and grown and you know he practices home meditation. And he will come, I will teach you home meditation. When his lungs itself collapsed completely, and when voice itself is not coming out, how can he educate you? How can he teach you? Om means what you are doing, om. So, what is the way to do? So, slow inhalation, slow exhalation. So, especially breathing is to make make you mindful. That's why when you think, you know, now there's going to be short hum, so Guru will say long hum. So these make your lungs, you can see, and my lung day by day only have become strong. You can see that. Otherwise, many of the people I see, as they go on practicing, and their lungs become weak, like endurance athlete. So, especially in pranayama, high intensity completely damages your respiratory and cardiorespiratory system. That's why I never give importance to high intensity will tax enormously your lungs. So today, with these breathing techniques having learned, so today very, very important. And breathing techniques themselves are exhaustive. You feel now how much you are already tired by just doing this. So I'm making you learn, follow the rhythm. Then once you accustom, then we'll be practicing. So we have practiced this. And then we have practiced today internal respiratory techniques, means how to fill and how to empty out completely. Powerful Shakti Chalana. Because tomorrow doctor, we will combine so, rhythm. I am teaching rhythm. So duration you have to inhale. When I say that much duration you have to exhale. So like this 7 rounds. I say again. So How you inhale? You have to follow the rhythm. And when I say sam, this is what we are going to practice. This is called cyclic breathing. These are completely relaxes the brain, relaxes the mind, and while listening itself, you enter into the samadhi. Every breathing technique, every pranayama, very powerful, experiential oriented when you practice. But if you practice as per the rhythm, because you cannot balance, you do not know how to balance the breath. Guru knows all that your inhalation as per the rhythm. Automatically you experience. The breath has to fall into the rhythm. What Guru gives you is the rhythm. And you just follow the rhythm, you experience. And slowly it takes time for you to understand, for you to practice. That's why pranayama has to be practiced only under the Guru. You cannot practice on your own, and it is very detrimental. Even the asana like, that's why. And it is because Guru knows how much duration to say, how much duration to cut, way to cut, way to not, how, because he is deciding the length of the breath, which is the most subtlest thing of your life. Means unless your Guru is skilled, and otherwise your prana is being played by other person, understand. And you don't service your vehicle, so also pranayama is much more subtler, so you should be very, very careful. So you must know and you must follow the rhythm. That's the way. Don't practice on your own pranayama. It kills you. I'm telling you, you won't get that. Now, you just start practicing, you start experiencing from the day one the power of the pranayama. In the West, there is no pranayama, I tell you. Some asana practice you practice. But pranayama, nowhere, whether it's the West or in India. And only inhaling from left, exhaling from right. And practice. If your belly is out, if you are doing, your blood pressure increases. All the unscientific breathing techniques everyone practices today, and it is going to create enormous problem. So we will practice bellow breathing, belly breathing, brain breathing, everything, but very systematically we should learn and we should practice. So till then, we practice. And one pranayama called Ajapa Gayatri pranayama, we need to practice. So as Yajnavalkya taught, but that we'll practice later. Oh. Bhur bhuvasva tatsa. विदुर्वरेण्यं भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्। ॐ भूर्भुवः सवितुर्वरेण्यं भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्। ॐ आपो ज्योति रसामृतं ब्रह्म वस्स अपानाय स्वाहा। ॐ प्राणाय स्वाहा। ॐ अपानाय स्वाहा। Shah Lord bless your children. May Lord bless your friend. May Lord bless your relative. May Lord bless your colleague. May Lord नमस्ते 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 नमो नमः हैव अ नाइस डे मे यू बी प्रोटेक्टेड नमस्ते।